Welcome back, everyone. This session we have Mark Reid. He's a research fellow at the Australian National University. He's holding a bachelor in mathematics at UNSW, and he got his PhD at the Computer Science School in UNSW as well. His research interest is in the area of learning theory, and today he presents prediction markers for us. So help me welcoming him on the stage.
Okay, thanks everyone for making it to the last session of what sounds like it was a very big week. Can everyone hear me up the back? You can hear me up the back? How's that? Any better? Okay, I don't know if I've got volume control here, so.
Yeah, it's maximum.
Okay, I'll just try and speak into my collar. So congratulations for making it through to the end of the summer school. I hear that you all had quite a fun night last night, so appropriately I'll try to keep this talk I'll keep the pace fairly slow, and I invite you to sort of jump in with questions at any point. And this is, I guess, a bit different to the other material in the rest of the summer school, as I'll be talking, I guess, mainly about concepts from economics, and in particular microeconomics, in the form of prediction markets. And towards the end, I'll do a survey of how some of these ideas that I guess originally came out of the economics literature have sort of made their way into computer science and machine learning. And I guess what I found interesting about this material is that a lot of ideas from machine learning seem to be very applicable to the analysis of these things called prediction markets. So I guess this is kind of like a machine learner's take on prediction markets and some of the results related to machine learning. So just for a quick show of hands, who's actually heard of prediction markets before? All right, so not many of you. Okay. So for those of you who have read into this a little bit, this hopefully won't be too slow. And for the rest of you, like I said before, feel free to jump in at any time with questions. I've purposely left myself a lot of time for on the slides so that if anything's unclear, just jump in and I'll try and elaborate with examples, okay? All right. So just to ease ourselves into this, I thought it'd be fun to play a bit of a game that hopefully demonstrates some of the ideas intuitively that we're going to be formalizing in this tutorial. So actually, I need someone to help me with this. Someone has got a phone where they can just add up some numbers and do a bit of math for me? Who wants to volunteer? Yeah, okay. Just need a basic calculator on the phone. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I want people to just call out how many jelly beans they think are in this picture. Estimate any way you want, but try and make reasonable guesses, okay? 400, okay. So can we just punch in 400 there? 650. See, we got a 600 as well? Yeah, just adding them. Sorry? 420. Hang on. So we want reasonable answers. So far we've got 400 and 600. That's two. 500? Can we add 500 to that? Okay, and there was a 420 as well, okay. Yeah. 1,002, that's a big guess. Okay, that's five. Did you get that one? Anyone else want to hazard a guess? You get to win all these jelly beans in the picture. I'll send you the JPEG at the end. Oh no. Someone else want to put in a guess? 220. 620. Okay, 620. So how many that we've got? Yeah, some at the back there? No. 560? 350? All right, we might leave it there. How many did you punch in? I've counted eight numbers. Okay, can you just give me an average there? 556. All right, so what we've done is just, you've thrown numbers at me. I've just aggregated them and asked you how many jelly beans. So when I counted them, there were 642. So I think someone here said 620. Was that you? No, someone said pretty close. You said 620? All right, so you win the JPEG of the jelly beans. Congratulations. So that didn't work quite as well as I thought. But what I was trying to demonstrate here was this. There's this idea that you might have heard called the wisdom of crowds. And the idea here is that if you have something uncertain that you want to predict, one method that sometimes works remarkably well is just asking a whole bunch of people for their input and averaging. And the idea behind this is that if the sort of noise in everyone's guesses is sort of independent and has zero bias, then when you take these averages, you're going to concentrate around the correct answer and hopefully get a good result. This has been used with great success, I think, in the example that springs to mind is in locating a submarine that had sunk somewhere. I think it was called the USS Scorpion. And what they did is they had no idea where it was, and so they got a bunch of sort of oceanographers and military experts and everyone to sort of place guesses on a map as to where they thought the submarine was. And then they were able to use the sort of some kind of Bayesian combination of those guesses to really narrow down the search area, and they were quite successful and found the submarine. So this idea of taking a whole lot of advice or input from a large variety of people and somehow aggregating them is one of the things we're going to be touching on in this tutorial on prediction markets. And yeah, so like I was saying, we're aggregating guessing and aggregating a bunch of guesses, and the idea is that it should give good results just by the sort of central limit theorem if you can make some reasonable assumptions about the noise. But there are a few problems with this approach. So as tempting as the JPEG of the jelly beans were, it's kind of an unfair process having this winner takes all. So normally when people play these guess the jelly beans in a jar competition, the person who gets closest gets the entire jar of jelly beans, and everyone else that gave their advice and also helped if you were using it to come up with an estimate, all of the other input that you got from all of the other people who were just slightly out, they get nothing. So you could argue that this sort of winner-takes-all way of incentivizing people to give you their guesses is a little bit unfair. And it's also quite manipulable. You would have noticed that I kind of censored someone's guess of about 50 up the back there. Because I thought it was a bit unreasonable. It would have made my little game work even worse than it did. So, if someone figured they're not going to have a chance of winning the whole thing anyway, then what's to stop them just making ridiculous guesses and ruining the process for everyone? So there are at least two disadvantages with this simple strategy for aggregating expert opinion. Not that you're... I guess maybe you all are jelly bean counting experts. So I was expecting it to go a bit better. What can we do about fixing this? Well, a slightly different approach we might want to take is I could set up a bunch of contracts. And just for the moment, I'm going to assume that I only want to estimate the number of jelly beans to within certain intervals. So this top contract here, I'm going to talk about contracts a lot in this talk. This top contract, if you own it, and when the outcome is revealed, n here being the number of jelly beans in the pitcher, if n is in the range 150 to 300, then this anyone who holds this contract will get paid a dollar. Similarly, this contract here, if n is in the range 300 to 450, this contract will pay a dollar and so on. So I've just set up five intervals here and contracts for each interval. And one thing we're going to talk about a lot in prediction markets is sort of buying and selling contracts like these. So there's some uncertain future outcome, namely the number of jelly beans in the pitcher, and we have a bunch of contracts that people can buy and sell. And suppose initially I set all the prices to be the following, so 5 cents for this contract here, 50 cents for this contract, 20 cents for this one, 15 cents and 10 cents for the bottom one there. If you saw those prices and I offered you the option to buy each of these contracts at the prices listed, you'd probably be quite keen to, right? So, for example, if you strongly believe that the number of jelly beans between 600 and 750, if you believe this with almost certainty, then for every contract you buy, you're going to make 75 cents, right? Because it's only costing you, 85 cents. I can't do math. It's only because it's going to cost you 15 cents to buy it, but you strongly expect to make a dollar out of it. So you'll get your 15 cents back plus another 85 cents if the outcome happens to be this contract. So what we're going to see is that these sort of setting of prices for contracts sets up something like a distribution over the various outcomes. The outcomes now being the number of jelly beans falling in a particular interval, and what we'd like to do is have these contracts traded with some central mechanism or with each other, and somehow having the disparate information and beliefs about the actual number of jelly beans somehow aggregated via the trading of contracts like these. So one question you might want to think about is that if someone came up to me and bought, 100 of these contracts at 15 cents each, how should I vary the price to sort of somehow incorporate that and make sure that people can't just make unlimited amounts of money off me? Okay, so this is the type of thing we're going to try and formalize and talk about. So any questions so far? Does anyone get this sort of idea of a high level idea of what we're doing here? Like I said, feel free to jump in any time if you want me to explain anything. Okay, so. We can interpret prices over those various contracts as a distribution. You might want to think generally why you should be able to interpret prices as distributions. So as a bit of a hint, what would have happened if I set all of the prices to be 5 cents for all of the contracts here? And now let's assume that the number of jelly beans is guaranteed to lie between 150 and 900. If they're all set to 5 cents, someone to just come along and buy one, as many contracts of all of them they can, and they're guaranteed that because the number lies somewhere in these range, they're going to be guaranteed a $1 payout. So I would get arbitraged, and someone will just be able to pump me for money. And so the way to avoid that is by actually having the prices sum up to one. If I make the sum greater than one, then people will be less willing to buy them because they can see that it's a bad deal. It's like when you go to the casino and, in roulette, they keep a couple of numbers off to the side just for the casino to win on, and no one else can win on those. It's like a tax or a fee on the contracts. Okay, so there's simple arbitrage arguments to argue why the pricing should represent a distribution. The interesting thing about this approach, as opposed to you just throwing me a number for your guess, is that you can express more refined beliefs about the distribution of the number of jelly beans. You can buy, if you weren't sure in the if you were unsure, if you thought it was about 600 jelly beans, you might want to buy some of this contract and some of that contract. You can kind of express your spread of beliefs via buying a bundle of contracts, and that gives more information to me about what your actual belief is. So what we have to figure out is the mechanism by which we need to update these prices when people buy or potentially sell contracts. And as a rough sort of first guess, if someone buys a contract, we should bump up the price. If someone sells one back to us, we should probably knock it down again. You can see here that if you have two people who have strong beliefs and they disagree a lot, they'll basically sort of fight it out, and the disagreements will be sort of traded out in some sense. And it decreases this problem with the person we had up the back there sort of making ridiculous guesses, because you have to put your money where your mouth is. You have to actually pay actual money to buy these contracts. And if you're going to make silly guesses, then maybe you can justify it as spending money on entertainment or something like that. But yep, question.
What's the range? Don't you have a problem
Well, actually, I guess this notation I'm using here, this is a kind of open interval, so it's up to but not including 600.
If you thought it was 600 or a bit more of a leap, you mm-hmm. would find two contracts to cover your spread.
Yep. Right. Yeah, so I mean, ideally, I just did this because I could fit the contracts on the slide, but I mean, what you would do if you wanted more refined estimates is, of course, you just shrink the size of these intervals. And so as you shrink the intervals, then everyone's going to probably have a bit of a spread.
Uh-huh.
No, why do you think you have to pay twice as much? I just split how much I was willing to pay across the two distributions, or I actually reflect on the prices that they're being charged for and adjust the distribution of my spend so that it matches up, sort of complements the prices. Because the aim here is not to hold the winning ticket, but to sort of maximize your expected winnings in some sense. So does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
Right. 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 But if you truly believe that it's 600, then you should just buy this one. But if you have a bit of a spread, then you should split your dollar accordingly. Yeah. No, but you can still reason about what your expected winnings are going to be. If you can sort of reflect and figure out what you believe the probabilities of all these events are, then you should be able to figure out the optimal split of your money and still come out ahead. I mean, you're right in the sense that, like I said, I chose these intervals quite wide so I could fit them on the screen, and you do lose a bit of what's called expressivity. So this is not the most efficient way of extracting precise values of the number of jelly beans. As I make the intervals narrower, I'll be able to pick up more subtleties in the way people express their beliefs. But for the purposes of the example, I had to keep them wide so I could fit them all on the screen. Does that sort of answer your question? I see your point, right? You're saying that someone whose belief lies in this interval only has to buy one, whereas if you're on the edge, you buy two. And that's basically a problem of the expressivity of the contracts. And the way to fix that is you just refine the interval.
Yeah, but you're still biasing the distribution.
Right, right. You haven't got as... There's a granularity issue. There's not... I can't easily express all distributions over the number of jelly beans at a sort of jelly bean by jelly bean level with these contracts. I think that's the point you're making.
Yeah.
If you overlap them, then you run into having to reason about sort of the pricing, and the reasoning becomes a little bit trickier. But yeah, you could potentially do that too. Okay, but anyway, we're going to formalize all this in a little while, and maybe as we go, it might answer your question. Okay, so overall, this idea of sort of buying and selling contracts that are contingent on some sort of uncertain future event, it's a mechanism that does two things. One, it incentivizes people to reveal their beliefs in hopefully a truthful fashion. And at the same time, by opening the market to lots of people, it aggregates a lot of potentially diverse beliefs into a single price. And we're going to look at a number of techniques for doing this. Okay, so we're going to be talking about prediction markets. So a lot of people have tried to define these. This guy, Arrow, and a whole bunch of other people, economists mainly, who worked in this area, had a nice survey article in Science in about 2008, and they basically tried to describe a prediction market as a forum for trading contracts that yield payments based on the outcome of uncertain events, which you can see kind of matches up with the jelly bean example I was talking about. Arrow is actually quite... Has anyone here heard of Arrow's paradox?
In Arrow.
Sorry?
In
Ken Arrow, yeah. Yeah, so it's that Arrow. Yeah, that's him. So he's, I guess, got roped into this because in some of the analysis, some of the simple models are based on what are now called Arrow-Debreu securities, which are a complete and disjoint set of securities for some collection of outcomes. And so he's been sort of attached with this work. But yeah, very, very famous economist. And so these forums for trading contracts at yield payments have been applied in a huge number of areas. Probably the most famous in recent years has been markets for the US president. Every time a US federal election comes around, if you watch the papers and listen to reports, you might hear people quoting figures from places like Intrade or Betfair. So these sort of commercial companies that set up these type of betting markets using some of the principles I'll be talking about in order to aggregate information about the chances of various candidates winning things like presidential campaigns. So what's interesting about these, who's heard of Intrade here before, these sort of reports? So it turns out that these reports have people have done a lot of empirical studies comparing prediction markets to things like polling and other mechanisms for trying to determine future outcomes. And these techniques, things like intrade prices, up to 6 weeks out from the event, tend to have much better predictive power than alternative methods for guessing winners. So empirically, at least, they've been found to be quite effective. So in this particular example, I don't know if you can read what's on the screen here, but basically they post these contracts, and I think they pay out $10 or something like that, and they set prices on them, and you can choose to buy or sell them at a given price, and then they adjust the prices using some formulas on the back end, and at any point in time, the prices give some kind of probability of each of the events here. It's whether Barack Obama is going to be the 2008 president or McCain. Okay, and it's quite interesting to watch how these things vary over time. When various news reports and things comes out, you can see them as shocks to the prices. Okay, so there's if you're interested in where these things get used, there's quite a nice book by Abramowitz called Predatocracy, and he describes sort of the history and the applications of these things. So one of the earliest examples was this Iowa electronic market. This was set up in Iowa as a sort of research market. It's got a kind of cap on the amount of money you can bet on various outcomes, and this has been what's driven a lot of the empirical research behind prediction markets. I mentioned Intrade already. There's Betfair. There's a thing called the Hollywood Stock Exchange where you get to bet on box office outcomes and various events in Hollywood using play money. And it turns out that these prediction markets get used internally by various companies. Google, HP, Yahoo have all used internal prediction markets to help make decisions about product releases and whether deadlines are going to get met and stuff like that. So they do get, they have been applied quite a lot in the past. Okay. So that's all well and good, but why as am I as a machine learning researcher interested in them? Well, I guess I did a bunch of work a number of years ago on understanding loss functions in machine learning. So my background's in learning theory, and I got quite interested in this question of how do you pick a loss function so that when you run a learning algorithm with that loss function, you can guarantee something about the consistency of your predictions and what kind of bounds can you put on the regret, et cetera, et cetera. And it turned out that there was this very old notion of properness from the economics literature that actually goes back to sort of McCarthy in 1954, the John McCarthy of Lisp fame, in fact, that worked a bit in economics as well as a number of other things. So he and a guy called Savage came up with this notion of properness, and the idea here is that you want the losses to be calibrated in some way, and I'll talk a bit more about that later. So from that, I got interested in how this notion of properness allows you to elicit information, beliefs of people by asking them to minimize their expected loss or their expected gain. And then in about 2010, I saw a very interesting paper by Yiling Chen and Jen Vaughan that showed that there was a very formal mathematical link between the way a certain class of algorithms in machine learning aggregate information and the way a certain class of prediction markets aggregate information. So it turns out you can say in a very formal sense that that markets are kind of learners in a very precise way. And then I think my fate was sealed when I read another paper which argued that you could potentially combine lots of distributed prediction algorithms or predictions via market mechanisms. You could just set up a whole bunch of learning algorithms that make predictions and have them sort of trade with each other under various assumptions in order to get some aggregated prediction out of the whole system. And it's sort of a bit like ensemble techniques, if any of you have seen those. So that's how I got into this stuff. So for this talk, what I'm hoping to do is just give you not so much dive into the real details here, but give you enough background so that when you finish this tutorial and you're still interested, you could potentially pick up some of these papers, and hopefully you'll have enough of the basic ideas in your head so that you could work through them and make sense of them. So I'm going to introduce some basic concepts from economics decision theory and some convex analysis. I'm going to look at three different models of prediction markets and describe some of the relationships between them. And then right at the end, I'll talk about some very recent work that's been coming out of the computer science machine learning community that gets to say some interesting things about how these markets work. Okay, and like I said, at any point in time, feel free to jump in with questions, comments, whatever. Okay, yeah, so this is the point that in some formal sense, you can say that markets learn the information that of its participants. So I'm going to show you that can be formalized. Okay, so I'm going to give you a quick sketch of a prediction market, talk about this is kind of important. You have to make a number of assumptions about all of the agents in your market in order to say anything about them. So I'm going to talk about a number of models that we use, and the two that I've focused on are what's called the expected utility model and, I guess, the risk measure model. I'm going to talk about, like I said, three different market mechanisms. One's based on equilibrium notions, another one's based on scoring rules, and the third's based on cost functions. I'll probably spend most of the time on the cost function one because that's the one I'm most familiar with. In order to relate these things to each other and also to machine learning, I guess the techniques that sort of underpin all of this is convex analysis, so I'll introduce enough convex analysis to talk about these relationships. And then I'll talk about how you can connect markets to learning, various optimization algorithms, and Bayesian updating. Okay, so who here has done some convex analysis? Wasn't there an optimization course earlier? So what got covered in that? Convex optimization? Everyone's familiar with convex conjugates and things like that after that? Oh, good. That helps. Okay. So let's try and sketch out this example, and I'll introduce a bit more terminology. So like in the jelly bean example, we can imagine now we're just trying to predict whether it's going to be cloudy or sunny on a particular day, and I can price these contracts of power at $1 at 50 cents each, and what we're interested in doing is sort of building a mechanism called an automated market maker that can take in a bunch of reports or trades from a variety of traders that hold a number of different beliefs, and somehow update the prices in order to reflect the interactions with the traders. So that's what we'd like to do. And the sort of overarching principle here is that the prices that the market maker assigns to these contracts in some sense represents an aggregate or consensus belief of all of the traders. Okay, so a market maker is an agent within a market that's always willing to buy and sell contracts. So you could imagine setting up a market of these contracts, but if everyone disagrees vehemently or can't find people, sorry, if everyone agrees perfectly, then there's going to be no trading happening. If people can't find people that disagree with them in a nice symmetric way. They're probably not going to trade with them. And so market makers are these sort of agents that sit at the center of a market and are always open to trade. And this provides what's called liquidity to a market, and it can sort of match people who are willing to trade now with complementary people who are willing to trade later in some sense. And the way it does this is by always being willing to trade and updating its prices in a way so that it doesn't run into too much trouble. So I guess a type of market maker you'd be very familiar with would be something like a bookie, where they set at some odds, they take bets, they might refine their odds, and they just keep taking bets. This is a type of market mechanism, but they're what I would call for-profit market makers. They tend to either set the odds or prices on the contracts so that they're guaranteed a profit by setting the prices to some more than one, or they just take a fixed charge off every trade that happens with them. So they're all well and good, but it's not so much what we're going to be interested in here. What we're more interested in is prediction markets that are specifically built for the purpose of aggregating information from a whole bunch of traders. And we might call these subsidizing market makers because they're willing to potentially pay money in return for collecting information. The type of questions we want to ask of market makers is how effective they are and how can we interpret their prices. And I've sort of done some work, along with a whole bunch of other people, on these questions. So the effectiveness question comes down to how do we build these market makers so that they can collect information but not have to pay potentially an unlimited amount of money to do so. So in that example where, you know, if I set up a market maker and I set all of my prices to 5 cents initially, someone could just pump me for money and I stand to lose a lot. So we'd like to, at the very least, guarantee that we can always be open for trading, but at the same time, not necessarily be pumped for money and potentially lose a lot. And the second sort of main question we want to do is, once we've set up one of these market makers, how do we interpret the prices at any point in time? What can we say about the prices that a market maker sets in relation to some model of all of the agents participating in the market? And we'll see there's a number of interpretations that you can set there. Okay. So, yeah, before we can answer these questions, well, so to answer the first question, I'll get to that at the end. We don't actually need a trader model. We can do that sort of independent of any assumptions about the traders. But for the interpretation question, we're going to need models of what agents believe and how they act. So we're going to have to look at modeling agents, which aren't things like in Zoolander. It's more like this. I've been told it's always good to put a pun, at least one pun, in a talk. So there you go. I've got that out of the way now. Okay, so who's heard of expected utility and utility from commerce? Okay, good. So quite a lot of people. So this the idea of a utility is it's a utility function for an agent is meant to represent some notion of satisfaction about some goods or money or whatever. And the idea here is that we're going to focus on utility functions as a function of money, and the idea is that if you have some number of dollars, X number of dollars, then that gives you some amount of happiness, which we'll measure in utils. And the reason you want to separate the notion of wealth from the notion of happiness is that it can be quite wealth dependent, how much money is worth to you. For example, if I find $100 on the ground, that's going to make me happy, but if Bill Gates finds $100 on the ground, it's probably not worth his time to stoop down and pick it up, as the story goes. So you want some way of modeling the fact that different financial positions hold different amounts of value to different people. And this is commonly done in economics through the notion of this utility function. And for this talk, we're going to assume, like many economists do, that this utility function is a concave function. It's strictly increasing and continuous, much like this diagram down the bottom there. And even though we've got these conditions, you can still model a variety of qualitative behavior. Like the concaveness measures is some modeling of the notion of risk aversion. So I much prefer to take, if I have two outcomes that might happen at the flip of a coin, this concave utility means that I would much prefer a single guaranteed outcome that's kind of at the average of these two than an uncertain outcome. So it gives you this natural notion of risk aversion and also this idea of diminishing returns. As I make more and more money, each unit of extra money means less to me. Okay, so just to give some examples here, a very simple form of utility would be a linear utility. This is where $1 is worth the same no matter how much money you currently have. And here we could have it, in general it's going to be of the form AX plus B for some positive constant A and constant B. And in the very simple case where A is 1 and B is 0, we get the kind of money equals happiness case where the utility of each dollar is worth exactly a dollar. So this is sometimes assumed for convenience, but it's not very realistic. Another commonly assumed utility function that's a little bit more realistic is the log utility. This is going to pop up time and time again. So log utility just says the amount of happiness or utility you get out of a certain amount of money is the logarithm of that money. And you can imagine you can also scale this by constant factors. And the intuition here is that, in some sense, doubling your wealth, if you like, gives you the same increase in satisfaction no matter where you are, because log of 2 times some amount of money is going to be log 2 plus the original amount of money. So the change in your satisfaction is always going to be log 2. And so this is gives you more of a model where, as I gain more and more, each fixed increase is worth less and less. It also has the property that it strongly avoids debt. So as x goes to 0, your satisfaction goes to negative infinity. And so this kind of acts as a barrier to going broke, if you like. So this is quite a commonly used utility model. And another one that pops up is the exponential utility, which is this... it's basically, that should be e to the negative ax, but it's 1 minus e to the negative alpha x on alpha, where alpha is what's called the measure of risk aversion. The larger the alpha is, the more concave this exponential utility is. And it has this interesting property that it's the demands that you derive from this utility, they're independent of the wealth that you have. So that's not the same as the utility is independent of the wealth, but the behavior that comes out of this utility is independent. I'll talk more about exponential utility later and also logarithmic utility. Is everyone happy with those as examples? So just to give you a picture, linear utility looks like this. If you have dollars versus utils, linear, exponential, logarithmic's got this sort of barrier property, and doubling your wealth gives you a constant increase. Okay, everyone happy so far? Okay, so once we have a utility, once an agent has a utility, we want to ask how they might react to people putting prices on the contracts I talked about at the very beginning. So if an agent has a utility U and some belief P, so now I'm going to assume that we have some fixed number of outcomes, 1 through to N, and this belief is just a distribution over these N outcomes. And we're also going to assume that the agent initially has some position, and this is just some holding of contracts where each contract pays out a dollar if outcome 1 occurs and 0 otherwise. And for convenience, you can assume that this X is 0, for example. So sort of key to decision-making in this model is the notion of expected utility. So this is what happens is if you have some position X, so each X is going to pay out X sub I dollars should outcome I occur. And what we'd like to do is, for each outcome I, we're going to compute the utility of that outcome and then just take the expectation with respect to that agent's belief. So it's just saying, if outcome one occurs, how much utility do I get? If outcome two occurs, how much do I get? And then just averaging them with respect to the belief in each of the outcomes. So we can sort of see how an agent with this sort of model of utility might react to a certain trade. Now, a trade here, I'm going to denote dx, and it's just some vector in Rn, and it represents a change in position. So if x represents the contracts that an agent holds, so it might have, you know, 10 of contract 1, 3 of contract 2, negative 4 of contract 3, this dx represents some change in position. If an agent's offered that change in position for a particular price, capital pi of dx, then the position after the trade, after the agent accepts this exchange, is going to be the initial position plus the trade minus this this quantity here. So this is the dollar value for that trade, dx, and this blackboard bold 1 represents cash in some sense. So this is a quantity that pays out a dollar regardless of the outcome that occurs. So the all ones vectors is a way of representing a bundle of contracts that will always give you a dollar no matter the state of the world, right? So this is effectively like money because it's risk-free. So this is the position that an agent ends up in, starting at the initial position, buys this DX, but has to pay for it by subtracting off a kind of risk-free outcome. And so we can ask then, what trade should an agent make if it has utility U, belief P, and position X to maximize its expected utility? And the answer is this optimization problem down the bottom there. So what we want to do is compute the expected utility of the position after trading DX, and we want to maximize that over all possible changes of position, right? So, yep.
Just a basic question, what does X measure in? Is that dollar amounts or is that number of contracts?
So X measures the number of contracts you have for each outcome. So here I'm going to assume that each contract is what's called an arrow de Brew security for each outcome. That is, all of the outcomes 1 to n have an associated contract that pays out a dollar if that outcome occurs and zero otherwise. And the vector x represents how many of each of those n contracts you hold. Make sense? So, no? Okay, so so let's take an example of whether it so suppose we've got two outcomes, whether it's rainy or not rainy tomorrow. So let's suppose they're the only possible outcomes for the weather tomorrow, and I have a contract that pays a dollar if it's not rainy and another contract that pays a dollar if it is rainy. This X vector would represent how many contracts of each type you hold. So X might be 10-5, which means that you hold 10 of the contracts that pay a dollar if it's rainy and 5 of the contracts that pay a dollar if it's not rainy. So that if it rains, you get paid 10 times the dollar, which is $10, and if it doesn't rain, you get paid 5 times the dollar contract, which is $5. So these X's are, I'll talk about them as bundles or positions, but they're basically how many of each of a particular type of contract you hold. Does that clear it up?
It has to be a whole number?
No, it doesn't have to be a whole number. They will, so I'll talk about a few models. So in one model, they all play at the same time in some sense, and in another model, they'll play sequentially, yeah.
Are you looking at this from the perspective of the market maker to
increase the... So we're going to be talking about how we can set up market makers in order to not lose, to extract information but not lose too much money in the process. Yeah, entropy will pop up. but I guess more generally, it's just that we want the market maker to form some kind of aggregate belief or consensus belief of the market. And exactly what that is depends on how we set up the market. Okay. Any other questions at this point? Yep.
So I've always been curious about expected utility here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. $1 million, something that constant returns a dollar.
Yeah. Is that, are you asking, is that reasonable to assume?
No, I'm asking why expected utility?
I can give sort of at least two answers to that. One, I guess, is historical. It's been studied a lot and it's convenient mathematically. The other answer, and I'll get to this in a little while, is that there are some axiomatic treatments of rational decision making by von Neumann and Morgenstern and Savage and others. And basically, if you assume that the way you make decisions is to construct preference over a whole bunch of different lotteries or bundles or positions or whatever you want to call them, if you require those that preference relation over these objects to satisfy certain reasonable properties, then it turns out that this expected utility or use of utility is sort of the only way you should make decisions. I'll introduce those axioms a bit later. I won't spend too much time on them, but I don't think it's 100% satisfying either, and there's definitely work on alternatives to expected utility, and I'll look at one of them, but that's the most common reason that's trotted out. There's this axiomatic take on rational decision making that yields expected utility. Yep.
So you don't consider the variance too much?
No. Yep.
You also consider the continuous case?
Yeah. So you can definitely set this up in the continuous case as well. I'm not going to do it here because it complicates things and I'll need, you know, reference measures and all that kind of nonsense. But yeah, you can. Okay, right, so this is a pretty key concept. When we have a notion of utility, that is how much is money worth to you, some belief over outcomes, and some starting position, we can sort of write down an expression for what trade an agent will make given some function that prices trades. Okay, usually you'll see, if you dive into this, that the agents usually come with some kind of constraint that avoids them going into debt. So this expression here says, if outcome I occurs, this is how much money I'll get. This is how much money I got if from my starting position. This DXI is how much money I got from the trade, but I had to spend pi of DX. And I want to ensure that there's several ways you can set up these constraints. You can either ask that no matter what I happens, I have to have positive final wealth, or you can just ask that in expectation I have positive final wealth. So this expression xi plus dxi minus pi dx is the how much money the agent will have should outcome I occur, and so this is, you want the expectation to be positive there. So for some utilities you don't need these constraints because, for example, log utility keeps you out of debt anyway. Okay, so let's have a quick example. So let's come up with a very simple pricing function. So remember, we want to understand how an agent behaves if they're given some deal on a trade that will change their position. So here we're going to assume a very simple pricing function. So pi of dx here is pi transpose x, and this is, so is everyone comfortable with me writing pi transpose x for the sort of inner product between pi and dx? So it's the sum over all possible outcomes of pi I times dxi. I'm just writing it as a vector for convenience. And so this pricing function has a little price vector little pi, and any trade will be just priced according to the sum of, you just sum over all of the outcomes and you're charged pi sub I for each component dxi. Right? So this is like linear pricing, if you like. And let's suppose we have this outcome where we have rain or not rain, and in this two outcome case, the belief I can write normally this is a vector, but I'm just going to express it in terms of a single number between 0 and 1, p and 1 minus p. This is the probability. This is the belief that it will rain. 1 minus p is the belief that it won't rain. And similarly, the price can be expressed with a single number between 0 and 1. The price for the, because we're going to assume price is always sum to 1, the price for the not for the rain contract is going to be pi, and the price for the not rain contract is going to be 1 minus pi. And another feature of the two outcome case is that because we're assuming that these outcomes are kind of complete, you should be able to convince yourself that buying a contract for the rain outcome is the same as selling a contract on the not rain outcome, right? So if I buy a contract on the rain outcome, I get a dollar if it rains. If I sell you a contract on the not rain outcome, I've got a dollar and I don't lose anything if it doesn't rain, right? So these contracts are kind of symmetric. So what's really important in this setup is basically the net position. What's the difference between the number of contracts dx1 you have on rain minus the number of contracts you have on not rain? So let's call that difference d. And then we can ask the question, how does a maximum expected utility agent behave in this setup? And what we have to do is we have to ask, how do we maximize, this is the belief that it'll rain, times this is this expression here, log w plus 1 minus pi d. This is the utility of the final position if the difference in contracts, this is the initial wealth w, and this is how much it costs to take the net position d. I should have put a few more steps on this slide. This is the probability of rain. This w plus 1 minus pi d is the final position should it rain. So it's the initial wealth plus the net number of contracts you had for the rain outcome minus the price it cost you to buy those contracts. So if you were to write that out, if you write out this expression down the bottom here, xi plus dxi minus pi dx, with these caveats here, the position you'll get is this w plus 1 minus pi d. And similarly, for the not rain case, you get 1 minus p times log w minus pi d. So that's going to be an expression for the expected utility under belief p. And if you solve this, you get an expression for d, which remember is your net position between the rain and not rain contracts. And you get a net you get an expression for d that you can write in terms of your initial wealth w, the price of the rain contract, and your belief in the probability of rain. And you know, if you stare at it a while, it has a fairly natural interpretation. So if you think of this term here in blue, w over pi, anyone tell me what that might represent? So if I've got initial wealth w and the price of a rain contract is pi, what does w on pi represent? Yes, yeah, so it's the maximum number of contracts you could buy for the rain outcome, right? So this is some sort of constraint. You're constrained by your wealth as to how many contracts you can buy. So that first term just tells you how many rain contracts you can buy. And this second term, which I've called edge, can anyone sort of come up with an intuitive explanation as to what that term's doing? So D represents the demand, how much they're going to buy. Right? So this is a sort of key term, the p minus pi. If p is your belief and pi is the price, this function is going to be positive if you believe rain is more likely than what the price suggests, and it's going to be negative if you believe rain is less likely than the price pi suggests. So it's zero when your belief matches the price, and it's going to go positive or negative depending on how your belief relates to the price. And 1 minus pi is like a kind of normalizing factor. But basically, this product is basically saying if you, however your belief deviates from the price, you should buy some proportion of the maximum number of shares you can in the range. So you should sell a bunch if your belief is less than the price, and you should buy a bunch if it's greater than. So this this scheme that you derive from log utility has actually been studied for a while. It's called Kelly betting, after a guy called Kelly from the 50s. And you can just do a quick sanity check here. If you believed 100% that it was going to rain, then this maximizing your expected utility would tell you to buy D equal to W on pi shares. So it would basically tell you to spend your entire capital on the contracts for rain. And the interpretation otherwise is that you're hedging somewhere in between. So if you believed absolutely that it wasn't going to rain, you'd get negative pi on 1 minus pi as the number of shares you would sell relative to W on pi. Okay, so it's actually relatively tricky to come up with nice closed form expressions for the behavior of an agent given some pricing function, their beliefs, and the utility in general. But in this particular case, we can at least check that it's somewhat intuitive. And numerically, you can certainly calculate these maximums and how the agent should trade. Okay. Any questions there? Nope. So from whenever I talk about maximum expected utility agents, you're assuming that they've got this set up and they're going to buy or sell shares depending on the solution to this optimization problem. Okay, so to answer a question I had earlier, why do people worry about expected utility so much? So this is what I was alluding to earlier. There's this theorem by von Neumann and Morgenstern that says, suppose an agent has a preference relation over these positions. Remember, positions are just bundles of contracts and they're uncertain. And we'll assume a number of axioms for this preference relation. And the idea with this theorem is that these axioms are meant to be natural and compelling. And if you believe them, then you have no choice but to model agents that with this type of preference using utilities and expected utilities. So the axioms are completeness. So what this is saying is that if someone were to offer you two different positions, you have to be able to compare them. So either X is a worse position than Y, X is a better position to Y, or X is you're indifferent between X and Y. You believe them to be equally good. So that's completeness. Transitivity is also fairly... So this means you can't... someone makes you an offer, you have to make a decision of which one you prefer, right? So that seems fairly natural. Transitivity says that if you prefer Y to X and Z to Y, then you should prefer Z to X. That seems fairly natural as well. Continuity says that if you have three different positions, X, Y, and Z, then you should be able to mimic... you should be able to find something that you like as equally as much as Y by mixing X and Z. So this one's maybe not as intuitive, but you could argue that it's reasonable. And this independence one, this one's a bit more intuitive. This says that if I definitely like Y more than X, and then you throw in this extra option Z, then any mixture... then adding Z in any mixture to X and Y shouldn't change the relative ordering of X and Y. So this on the left says that I'm going to offer you with probability P the position X, and with probability 1 minus P this position Z. And if you definitely like Y more than X, then you should definitely like probability P of Y plus probability 1 minus P of Z more than the alternative. So it's basically saying if you definitely think Y is better than X and someone throws a sort of extraneous position into the bargain, you shouldn't change your mind, basically. And so there's a very famous result from the 50s as well that says that if you believe that agents make decisions, they have these preferences and they basically make a decision where they choose their most preferred position using this relation, then there exists a utility function and a belief so that you can effectively replace this comparison with the preference operator by an expected utility. So if your preference relation satisfies those conditions, then you can just swap it out for this method here, taking expected utilities and comparing expected utilities with the positions. That was a pretty powerful result, and that's one of the big reasons why economists in particular study expected utility. It's a bit of an aside from what we're doing, but I thought I'd throw it in there because it's a fairly important result in the history of this stuff. So now that I've told you that this is a kind of important result, I'm going to say, well, there's another way you can actually model agent behavior, and that's using a notion that comes out of finance and insurance called risk measures. And here, unlike utilities, which assign this kind of personal, fairly ambiguous notion of utility to positions, risk measures assign dollar values to positions. So the idea here is we want some function that takes this position. Remember, a position is some holding in it's a holding in contracts that will pay out depending on some uncertain event. And what we'd like to do is actually map that big uncertain bundle down to a single dollar value. We'd like to say, how much money would we have to accept the uncertainty that's inherent in this bundle? And that's what convex risk measures do. They assign monetary values to positions. And this is potentially independent of any belief in the outcomes. So economists like their axioms, and so there's an axiomatic framework for risk measures as well, and these are also arguably quite natural. If I have two positions and one is X is worse than Y, then the risk I assign to X should be bigger than the risk I assign to Y. So the way I think about this is if someone offers you $10 if it rains versus $10 if it doesn't rain, that's one position you could take. Another position is you'll get $100 if it rains and $100 if it doesn't rain. Then clearly the first position, which offers you only $10 no matter the outcome, should be considered more risky than one that's a guaranteed $100 payout, right? Because you'd like to... The more money you can guarantee you have, the less risky the position is. So that's why there's this change of sign here. This convex notion is also fairly natural. It says that if I have two positions and I mix them with some number alpha between 0 and 1, then it should be less risky to take the hedge position than the positions separately. And this final one's an interesting one, and one I've spent a bit of time looking at. This says that a risk measure should be cash invariant. That is, if I have some position, and then I get given a riskless position, remember this one vector represents a guaranteed dollar regardless of the outcome. If I get offered C times that, I should reduce my risk by C dollars. So basically, if I've got some uncertain position, and you say, I'm going to give you $10 no matter what, my risk should go down by $10 because you've effectively taken that risk away, right? So these three axioms are what's expected of what are called convex risk measures, and these were sort of proposed around 2002, and they're in this book, nice book by Fulmer and Sheed in 2004. And a lot of people have studied the properties of these, but they're not the same as utilities. They have quite a different interpretation. So just as an example, this entropic risk here, I'll talk about a couple of times. If you have a position X, you take this you say that the risk of X is this operation here, log expected value of outcomes drawn from P of e to the negative xi. So that should look familiar to some people, right? Anyone seen this log sum x expression before? Maybe earlier in the week? Yeah. So interestingly, it's quite closely related to the log partition function, and happens to be a measure of risk. Okay, so as well as maximum expected utility agents, I can talk about risk agents. So instead of maximizing utility, we want to consider agents who minimize their risk. So given a risk measure in some position and one of these pricing functions again, instead of maximizing expected utility, we can ask, we can model agent behavior by one that will minimize its risk. And the minimization problem it has is how should I change my position by dx if I have to pay pi dx to change my position? So here, this is measuring the risk of the new position, x plus dx. And because I had to pay pi dx dollars, my risk is actually going to go up by pi dx because by this cash invariance, if I'm given $10, my risk goes down by $10. But if you take $10 from me, my risk is going to go up by that amount. So this is the risk of the new position, and this is what I paid for it. So you want to find the dx that sort of trades off the price with the change in risk. And this cash invariance property means that the demands they make is independent of wealth. So that just means that if you add a guaranteed $10 to my position here, it'll just get subtracted off the price. It turns out you can, although they're not the same, you can sometimes relate utilities and risk measures. If you have a utility, you can create what's called the certainty equivalent here. You can define a risk measure to be the smallest amount of cash you'll have to add to your position so that your utility is positive. I'm not going to go into that very much, but it's just to point out that they're related. And in fact, if you take this exponential utility I mentioned earlier, you get entropic risk out using this construction. Okay, any questions so far? So we're still modeling agents. Just to give an example, you can imagine you have two agents, both with one with risk measure rho 1, one with risk measure rho 2. This one, the risk measures sort of come out, I guess, of the insurance community. So it's not so much bets, but rather how much are certain outcomes worth to me. And so this first agent thinks that if it's sunny, that's worth about $30 to me. But if it's rainy, it's worth negative $200. Maybe I'm like running some event and I don't want it to rain. And so they can express their how much each of these outcomes are worth to it, and that's their position. Agent 2 will lose $100 if it's sunny and gain $50 if it's not sunny, and might ascribe a risk value of $80 to that, and this one has a risk of $140. And what's interesting about these risk measures is they can sort of find a mutually beneficial trade. So two agents with these risk measures and these initial positions might come to an agreement where if it's sunny, this agent will pay that agent $20, and if it's cloudy, the second agent will pay the first agent $40. And what this has the effect of doing is it can actually decrease the risk of both agents. So there's sort of a mutually beneficial trade that can happen here. And if such a trade were to happen, so if X1 was to subtract the dx position and X2 was to gain it, and you were to sort of minimize the total welfare, it turns out you can express this in terms of what's called an infimal convolution, and it gives you some notion of global risk for the two agents together. And I'll talk a bit more about this at the end, but the point here is that for these risk agents, and also it's less clear for the maximum expected utility agents, but the notion of trade is it can have mutually beneficial outcomes if you have people with different positions. Okay, we're going for time. Okay, so I'll talk about one prediction market mechanism, then we'll have a quick break, and then I'll talk about the other two, and then wind up with the machine learning stuff. So what we've seen so far is a whole bunch of ways of modeling agent behavior. And I guess wherever you've seen things like utilities and risks and things like that, one connection you can immediately make with machine learning is that these things could be integrated into systems that are making predictions with learning algorithms. You could have a learning algorithm coming up with the beliefs for certain outcomes and then bolt on top of that these decision theoretic concepts like risks and utilities and then have agents combined together. And we'll see an example of that type of structure towards the end. Okay, but what I'm going to talk about first is what are called equilibrium markets, and these are kind of the classical. No, so they're generally not comparable. So sometimes for some utilities, you get convex risk measures using that construction. For some utilities, you don't get convex risk measures, and so they're less nice to work with. Not all risks are expressible using that construction. So there exist risks that cannot be expressed as this certainty equivalent for some utility. So they're quite different. Yeah, so it turns out that, well, risk measures, they have this history in insurance and finance. They give this sort of, they're actually closely related with, I guess, robust decision theory or robust Bayesian methods. So some of the risk measures model a sort of robust Bayesian methods. So the idea that instead of a single belief, you have some range of beliefs that you're equally uncertain about. So you can use risk measures to model that sort of behavior. But basically, I mean, the reason I got interested in them is that they're closely related to entropies, and they also, they're very amenable to convex analysis. but they're not, they allow you to do a different type of modeling to maximum expected utility agents. And only in a few cases do they line up perfectly, yeah. Yeah, any other questions? Okay, so equilibrium markets are kind of this classical way of trying to understand the interaction between a whole lot of agents. So there's this notion of there's many notions of equilibria. The one that's particularly relevant here is what's called a Walrasian equilibrium. And here we imagine now, instead of just looking at a single agent, we imagine we have a market of agents with a whole lot of different utilities and initial endowments or goods or wealth, if you like. So an agent little a is going to have some utility U superscript A, and it's going to start off in some position X superscript A. And remember, these positions are just some you can think of them actually as a random variable. If outcome I occurs, then you get some amount of money dependent on I. Okay, and X is just a bundling up of that random variable. If you have this endowment of goods, the reason you can think of it as like wealth is that if someone tells you what the prices of all of those goods are, then you can compute your wealth just by summing all of the prices over all of the goods you hold. So we're going to call this wealth W superscript A. The wealth for agent A, subject to prices pi, is just pi transpose X superscript A. And it's basically if the agent A were to sell everything it owns at the prices pi, that's how much money they'd get. And what we're going to assume all the agents are trying to do is find the best position that they can afford. They want to maximize their position Y. They want to maximize the utility of the position Y, subject to being able to afford it. So this here is the price of the new position, and this is the price of the old position. And basically, this says the agent can move into any price they like, provided they can pay for it. Okay, so this is a classical setup for studying equilibria, and actually it's a bit more general than what we need, because these utilities are just arbitrary functions from goods to utils, and we're going to be using a special case when the goods are actually these contracts. So we talk about the utility for some bundle Y being the expected utility under some belief. So the idea here is that we have a whole bunch of agents. They have a whole bunch of different beliefs about the future. They have a whole bunch of different valuations of positions in the future. And we want to see whether or not there's some consensus that can be formed amongst all of these competing beliefs and valuations. And the constraint we'll put on this market is that contracts or goods have to be preserved. So any agent's allowed to trade with any other agent. So I can, if I want to sell you 10 shares of contract one, then I lose those 10 shares, but you gain them. So no matter what trading happens, the total number of contracts or the total number of goods has to remain constant. So the market can move. You can think of the market as an allocation of positions to every agent. But the constraint is that if you sum over all of those positions, that has to remain constant no matter what the final position is. Okay, so that's what preserving contracts means. And we'll say that a market clears at a particular price, call it pi star, if there's one of these contract preserving positions, so that everyone is happy. Everyone basically maximizes their utility. That is, so this is the contract conserving condition. So if I sum all of the XA over A, these are the initial positions, and the YA the final positions, and they've got to remain the same. And everyone has found a YA which is equal to their maximizing position, utility maximizing position. If you can find an allocation YA and one of these prices pi star, that pair, that price allocation pair, is called the Walrasian equilibrium for that particular market. Seems kind of complicated. Initially, it may seem impossible, and this kind of interest economists for a very long time, and there's a very famous theorem which gives sufficient conditions for when you can find one of these equilibrium pairs, the price and the allocation. And this goes back to this guy Arrow, who we mentioned before. Arrow and DeBrew have a paper in 1954 where they came up with the conditions on this, and basically it says that we need all of the utilities for the agents to be continuous, concave, and increasing, which we're kind of assuming off the bat. And if everyone, this condition is a little bit different. So this is basically saying that everyone has to start with a little bit of every contract. So if everyone's owns some small amount of every contract or every good, and you have this condition on the utilities, then you're guaranteed that you can always find this clearing price and market position so that everyone's satisfied. This is really surprising. I don't know how many else of you find this surprising, but if you just imagine setting up a whole bunch of agents with a variety of beliefs and one of these utility functions, this is kind of really surprising that this works at all. You might want to think about how you actually find these prices. So this theorem famously was non-constructively proved, so they had to use fixed point arguments and all this quite technical mathematics to come up with this existence proof, but But then it immediately raised the question, like, how do you actually find one of these equilibria given a collection of agents? And the answer is that it's hard. There's a process called I can never pronounce it because it's a French word, tâtonnement, which is French for groping, which is basically you take guesses and you update the guess and you try to set the... So if you set the price and these people are unhappy, you change the price a bit and make them a bit more happy, and then you maybe have to change it a bit more. There's basically this fairly complicated and difficult process to finding these equilibria. And one thing that got me intrigued in, and I think what got a lot of sort of machine learning and optimization people interested in prediction markets, is that the sort of sequential models that I'll talk about after the break can be viewed as a sort of learning-inspired way of finding solutions to these equilibria problems. And in fact, there are a couple of cases where we can say exactly that these sequential prediction markets are guaranteed to find these type of equilibria. Okay, so before I go into scoring rules, I'll just for fun over the break, I'll give you something somewhat unrelated to think about. So when I was looking into elicitation and everything, I found this puzzle. I think it hasn't got anything to do with economic elicitation, but it's kind of a fun puzzle that you might want to think about over the break. So we're going to play a game. So you think of some polynomial with arbitrary degree. So, you know, it could involve x to the power of 240 or whatever. The coefficients have to be non-negative integers. And you write one down on a scrap of paper and stick it under the table or whatever. I'm going to tell you some value x1. You're going to tell me the value of your polynomial at x1. Then I'm going to pick some x2, and you're going to tell me the value of your polynomial x2, and then I'm going to just tell you exactly what your polynomial is. So you might want to think about how I do that. Something totally unrelated to prediction markets, but it's a fun puzzle, and you can... Whoever gets me the right answer, the process I'm using after the break gets a JPEG of some jelly beans. Thanks. Sorry. Maybe a slightly simpler version is if you put in x1 equals 1, then you just get the sum of the coefficients. And you know that because they're non-negative, that has to be bigger than any single coefficient. So now take the smallest k such that 10 to the k is larger than that sum, and now feed 10 to the k in as x2, and then, yeah, like you say, you'll get basically blocks of 10 to the k, and you'll be able to read off all of the coefficients from the blocks, yeah. So nice. I don't know. I thought it was a cute puzzle. All right. Let's get back into it then. where did I get it? Okay. Right. So where did we get up to? So we talked about agent models. We talked about this Wallacean equilibrium for markets. And so just to explain a bit more about that. So the idea there is... there's not really what I'm going to refer to as a market maker in the Wallacean equilibrium setup. So this is just a kind of theoretical idea that if all the agents were able to interact with any other agent, all it's saying is that there exists some price in which everyone would be able to find trades so that everyone's happy simultaneously. There's not any centralized agent that's trading only with the other traders. It's just showing that there exists some kind of stable state amongst all the traders. So what we're going to talk about now is slightly different to that. I think as I was saying to someone in the break, that notion of Wallacean equilibrium is got a very classical economics feel to it. And I guess the models I'll talk about now, some of the ideas are derived from economics, but you'll see they've got a much more of a computer science-y flavor, in the sense that they're very procedural and very algorithmic and sequential. So the idea is that in the classical economic setup, you're trying to magically come up with this single price and prove that it exists. In these sequential market making mechanisms, it's more about how do we set up a mechanism so that it interacts with the traders one by one, but in such a way that it still collects the information in a reasonable way. And in very special cases, you can show that the processes that are implemented by these market makers actually match up with the equilibrium analysis that the economists do. Okay, so to talk about the first of these mechanisms, I'm going to have to introduce this idea which is called scoring rules. So I alluded to this at the very beginning, like how do you get people to tell you truthfully what they believe? And a pretty good trick is you pay them. But that doesn't always work. So if I really, really want to know what Finn believes about the weather tomorrow, I could ask I could say, tell me what you believe the weather is tomorrow and I'll give you $100. And you could tell me any old nonsense and just pocket the $100 and I wouldn't be any the wiser, right? So you might believe that it's 80% chance of sun and 20% chance of cloud, but you tell me exactly the opposite and you just take my money, and that's not a very good mechanism if I want to actually find out what you believe, right? So we'll call that the naive mechanism. A less naive mechanism might be to make the payment contingent. So now I say, I'm only going to pay you the $100 if the event that you said was more likely occurs. And this is slightly better because now you're not going to tell me the opposite of what you believe, but you might tell me something that's consistent with what you believe, but only just, right? So if this weather person believed that it was 80-20% chance of rain versus no rain, they would still get exactly the same payment if they told me it was 51-49%, right? And so, this is the way they're viewing the outcomes, and they figure, well, it doesn't really matter if it's actually cloudy because I'm still going to get paid the same no matter what I tell you the probability of cloudiness is. So it's slightly better than the naive mechanism, but it's still not actually telling me what the weather person actually believes. So let's generalize this a bit more. Rather than just making the single $100 contingent on the outcome, we will set up a more general, it's called a scoring rule, where what I pay you depends on what you tell me in a much more fine-grained way than just if it's more likely to rain or not. So a general mechanism is where I say, I will pay you S sub I of Q dollars if you report the probabilities Q. Now Q here is a probability vector over outcomes. If you report Q and the outcome's I, then I promise to pay you S sub I of Q is the notation I'm going to use. And so this is a fairly general mechanism. And now we want to, this is meant to just illustrate that if you tell me Q, which is what's being told, then you'll get varying amounts of money depending on the outcome for that report. And as this report changes, the relative amounts of money will change, usually continuously with the report. And so the question becomes, how do I construct these functions, the function of Q that depends on it being sunny and the function of Q that depends on it being cloudy? How do I design these functions in such a way that you'll tell me what you actually believe and not just something else, right? Can anyone think of any ideas before I jump in with solutions? Those of you who haven't skipped ahead and looked at the slides. What property do we want of these S's if I want you to tell me the truth? Any ideas? Oh, okay, well, luckily I've got the answer on this slide. I'll call this function, so this is a vector-valued function S. I'll call this function a scoring rule. And like I said before, it pays S sub I of Q dollars if the person I'm using it on reports the probabilities Q, which is a vector with that assigns probability Q1 to outcome 1 up to Qn to outcome n. And if you, that's what the agent reports. If, let's suppose you're the agent, if you believe that the outcomes are actually distributed according to the probabilities P1 through PN, and this symbol here is shorthand for probabilities over N outcomes, it's meant to represent a simplex, then your expected payment is maximized by choosing Q star so that you get the maximum expected payment under what you truly believe, right? So the game you're going to play is I'm going to tell you how this function works ahead of time. I'll write down a formula for it. And now you, being very crafty, have some belief in the actual outcomes, but you want to just maximize how much money you have. So what you're going to do is try and figure out what the best report for you to say is in order to maximize how much money you expect to get under the beliefs P. So what you're going to do is choose a Q star which is bigger than than this expected value for any other choice of Q. Right? So this is how we're going to assume the agents behave, because we're assuming some kind of linear utility in this case, so that you're just trying to maximize the amount of money you get paid. And so this is the game that we can assume that the agent's going to play. As a mechanism designer, what I want to do is I want to construct this scoring rule, this function S sub I, in such a way that if you play this game, then your Q score will match P. I want you to be forced in some sense to return the probability of the outcome that you actually believe. So that's sort of what I was saying here. The key property we want of this score function to ensure truthful reporting is that your optimal choice of report matches your true belief in the underlying outcomes. And this property we'll call properness, or we won't call it, but like I said before, John McCarthy, the famous computer scientist, he actually developed this idea and then later Savage studied it back in the 50s. So they called this type of scoring rule proper. And the property is that the reporting your actual belief P will maximize the expected payoff, and that maximizing property is just expressed as no matter what other Q you choose, this expected value when you report the true probability is going to be larger. And I'm probably going to flick a lot between these two notations. So this notation is the expected value of an outcome drawn from your belief P of the reward on outcome I given the report P. But I'm going to abuse notation slightly and bundle up this whole vector for every outcome into this vector S of P. So this S of P is a vector representing a payout for every outcome. And then if I take the inner product of this vector with the probability, I just get the expectation. So this notation and this notation are equivalent. So properness is basically saying for all distributions P and reports Q, this value, this expectation here, has to be bigger than the one on the right there. Like I said, I was looking at loss functions, and you can kind of think of scores as the negatives of loss functions. And I encountered this in a paper by Andreas Bouyer and some colleagues. And it's a very kind of natural and simple assumption to make about a loss function or a score, but it has a surprising amount of structure. And I spent a fair bit of time looking into this. And I'm constantly surprised at how much you get out of this fairly simple assumption. So, for example, one thing you can do is if you make some differentiability assumptions on this score function, you can set up a Lagrangian for this optimization problem. So now we want to, given a belief P and a report Q, what does this condition tell us? Well, if we set up the Lagrangian, this is just the expected score for Q given belief P, and this is a constraint that Q is actually a probability. And if you work that through, take derivatives, set to zero, etc., you get you get a condition on the derivative of S in expectation should be constant, and in fact zero. And what that gives you is that it tells you something about how the components of this S function have to relate to one another. It relates. This equation is basically putting a set of constraints on the partial derivatives of this S function, or the derivatives of the partial scores of S. And that gives a lot of interesting geometrical structure that I'll touch on a bit later. But this is a sort of key notion that drives a lot of incentive-based mechanisms. You just say, well, let's consider all possible ways of incentivizing people, and now let's try and fix it so that it does the right thing. Here's some examples. So the way I'm going to think about these functions is in the two outcome case, remember I can represent probability vector just by a single number between 0 and 1. So this, you can interpret Q as, say, the probability of it not raining, and 1 minus Q is the probability of rain. In this case, what properness constrains is sort of the relationship between two functions. One function is the score when outcome one occurs, and I got this the right way around. Yeah, the score when outcome one occurs and the score when outcome two occurs. And what you want to do is you want to guarantee that these two curves are related in some way, as I pointed out in the previous slide. And I have a picture a bit later which shows you exactly how they're related. But some examples of functions that do have this properness property is our friend the logarithmic loss, or the logarithmic scoring rule. So this is just a scoring rule that says if you give me a report Q, then I will pay you log of the probability you assign to the outcome that actually occurred. So log Q sub I. Another proper scoring rule is this quadratic scoring rule. So this notation here is just saying this is the delta function for outcome I, and this function returns 1 if I prime equals I and 0 otherwise. And the quadratic scoring rule just sums up over all of the possible outcomes your probability minus delta I of I prime and sums up the square of all these things. It's like trying to take the square distance between, summing up all the square distances between your point and a probability simplex and all of the vertices, if you like. So it turns out these two are proper. You can, if you set up that Lagrangian and solve it for these particular choices, you do indeed get that these are proper. An example of an improper score is a linear loss function. So it's exactly like this. It's measuring the difference between each of your probability assignments for each of the outcomes and kind of the assignment that puts all of the mass on a single outcome. But instead of taking a squared value, you take an absolute value. It turns out if you reward people in this way, it's not proper. What ends up happening is that the reports are maximized by just pushing the report to the most likely event. So it ends up being a bit like the less naive mechanism I talked about before. It doesn't incentivize people properly. So they're proper scoring rules. They're quite interesting objects to play with, and like I said, they have quite a number of connections with loss functions because they're effectively the opposite. So this picture is quite an interesting way to think about these proper scores. So what's happening here, it's a bit complicated, but imagine you're in the two outcome case, and this axis along the front, the x-axis, or the p-axis, is the probability that you believe outcome one occurring, and one minus p is the other outcome, probability of the other outcome occurring. So for each P and Q, where Q is the report you're making, there's some score that you get, which is the expected score under the expectation with respect to P and the report Q. And At this end of the spectrum, when p is 0, if I take the expectation when p equals 0, I'm just going to be pulling out the score for outcome 1. And the function is, this is the sort of partial function for outcome 1 given the report q. And you can see it's a function of q, and it sort of goes up against this axis here. Similarly, the other function is for the second outcome, and it's a function that sort of goes in the opposite way. It's a bit like it's kind of like that diagram there with the two blue curves is sort of what you get if you imagine looking at this diagram from the left on the two functions that squashed down. And what's interesting is that for any choice of as you vary p, the belief, all you're really doing is linearly interpolating between two points that are defined by q, right? So for each q you choose, I get some value of s1 of q and I get some value of s2 of q, and the expectation is just a linear combination of these two values, right? So an expectation is just, you know, p transposed by s of q. So if I pin down those two endpoints, then this red line is an example of how the expected value of the score changes as I vary p. And what we're after for properness is that if I take the maximum value, so fix a q, which is basically how far back in the picture we're going, and then trace this red line as a function of p, and as we vary q, we're going to get a range of different red lines. And the properness property says that they're maximized along this diagonal where p equals q. So this dotted diagonal along the top is where p equals q. And we want that, so for each choice of p, we're going to get some function that goes up and then down, and we want all of their maximums to line up along this diagonal. I don't know, maybe that's less insightful for you, but I found it a fairly neat way to think about these functions. I guess the key point is that the functions of q is what the mechanism designer gets to design, and then the beliefs are basically a linear operator of these two endpoints. Okay, and like I was saying before, losses are just gains upside down, so you just invert. Actually, this picture is an upside down version of one I used in a paper because I was talking about losses. But when you think about losses, this properness property has a nice interpretation for losses as well. When you're running learning algorithms, if we want these learning algorithms to output probabilities, we'd like them to be consistent in the sense that if the data was generated from some probability p, then minimizing the loss given a lot of data should return probabilities that match the probabilities that generate the data. So this notion in learning theory is called consistency, and in some sense this truthfulness property of proper scoring rules is analogous to this notion of consistency in learning theory. So that's basically how I got into this whole game. So yeah, there's a paper I have with a co-author in JMLR where we look at the ramifications of assuming properness for losses. But they came out of this this work by economists to do with scores. Okay, so how do we make use of this? So what we've got now is we've got these functions that we can use to elicit beliefs from people fairly reliably. We're going to assume that people just want to maximize how much money they get, and they'll return. If we offer rewards according to these scoring rules, then we'll get back beliefs. But how do we use them to build a market and aggregate lots of different beliefs from people? Well, there's this sort of famous paper by an economist called Robin Hanson about 2003 who built on this work on proper scores to build what he called a scoring rule-based market maker. And the idea here is that you effectively you use a scoring rule to interact with one agent who tells you their belief, and then you sort of pass on an updated version of the scoring rule to the next agent who then tells you their belief, and then you then pass on an updated version of the scoring rule to the next agent, and so on. So you fix one of these proper scoring rules. These are functions from distributions over n outcomes to R, And the market maker starts with some initial belief, P naught, and then the market maker interacts with the agent sequentially. So I'm gonna label the rounds with little t. So imagine we've got capital T rounds. In each round, we get an agent who reports Q superscript T, which is a probability, in exchange for a contract X. And these are like the jelly bean contracts. Except we make them pay, the way we say how much they pay out is by using this difference in scoring rules. So this contract will pay out on outcome I, it'll pay out the score for outcome I of what the agent reports, but it'll subtract off the score for outcome I for the previous belief of the market maker, and then the market maker just sets their belief to be what the last agent reports. So when the next agent comes along, they'll be basically updating the market maker's belief by trading against this difference here. So if the next agent comes along and they completely agree with the previous agent, then they won't have any incentive to trade. But if their opinion is slightly different from the previous agent, then there'll be some margin that they can exploit, much like what we saw with the logarithmic utility, maximum expected utility maker. There's some margin they can exploit, and they'll buy a bunch of contracts in exchange for their belief. So probably the simplest and one of the more well-studied examples of this market maker is if you set the logarithmic market scoring rule to be log pi. This is just the logarithmic rule we saw before. So you can imagine, I don't really have any, I should have run a simulation or something of this, but hopefully the idea is fairly straightforward. We fix ahead of time this mechanism for paying out agents for their beliefs, and then all we do is we record the last agent's belief in return for a payment that's the difference in scores between the previous belief and the current one. And the idea is that after a lot of trading, eventually no agent will have an incentive to update the belief. Or actually what's nice about these mechanisms, if suddenly there's some new information that's revealed to people, then there might be some ability to exploit the incorrectness in the scores that the difference between what these scores are reporting and what the agent believes. So they're quite dynamic in the sense that as new market comes to hand, agents can sort of factor that into the way they interact with the market maker. Okay, so this is a fairly classic example of a prediction market. You can see it's got a very different flavor to the equilibrium analysis. Only one agent at a time interacts with this special agent called a market maker, and the interaction is very sequential, and we don't say anything about convergence or anything here. I'll talk a bit about that later. But so a natural question is, what if anything does this converge to, given some assumptions about the beliefs in a market? And I'll talk about that in a little while. Another question is, alluding to what I said in the last part, is this a safe mechanism to use from the point of view of a market maker? Could there be some devious agents that could potentially pump an infinite amount of money out of this market maker here by manipulating it? And people have answered these questions, and I'll touch on them in a little bit. So although these scoring rule market makers were sort of the first type, and they've got a natural connection to these scoring rules, I'm going to change gears a little bit and talk about a different style of market maker called cost function market makers, and then I'll show that they're actually more or less the same thing. What I like about the cost function market makers is they're a lot more interesting to analyze, and you can prove a lot more things about these market makers by switching to this other point of view. Right, so in the scoring rule markets, we had agents reporting probabilities and then getting contracts back based on some scoring rule. But if you think about more traditional markets, people, what usually gets traded are the contracts. People don't usually report what they believe. And so it'd be, you can ask the question, is it possible to have agents trading in these securities or contracts, these things that pay out various amounts of money depending on an outcome, and then somehow figure out what the prices and aggregate beliefs are and everything from this more, arguably more natural style of trading. And it has a few advantages. So switching from scoring rules where agents have to kind of introspect and think about the distribution, their belief as a distribution over outcomes, to something where they just buy and sell contracts is a little bit more flexible, because you can actually set up contracts or securities where you don't have to have a single security or contract for a single outcome. You could have, for example, you could set up securities for horse racing, where you say, I have 10 securities, each one corresponds to a horse placing somewhere in the top three out of a 10 horse race. And if you think about horse races, there's 10 factorial outcomes, but here we're only interested in 10 contracts. And this style of, by flipping to this view where we're buying and selling contracts, we can actually model this a lot easier than via scoring rules, where an agent would have to potentially report their belief over 10 factorial outcomes. So that's primarily why we switch views, but it turns out that they're actually the same thing, just looked at a bit differently. So what's the cost function? So so here now we're going to be talking about the market maker assigning prices to trades. And the most general setup we can think of is that if an agent wants to buy a trade DX, but there's been some history of trades DX1 through to DXT, then this is, you know, we'll say that the cost of the trade given the history is this expression here, cost DX given D1 to XT. But we can immediately say, well, it would actually be nice if this function that assigns prices to trade is path independent, in the sense that if I were to, the price that's assigned to the sum of two trades, given some history, should be the same as if I bought DX first, given the history, and then bought, DX prime first, and then bought DX plus the cost of buying DX. So you want this cost function to kind of factorize over all of the ways you could potentially split up a trade. So this path independence property actually has some strong implications, and it means that you can go from this representation for a cost function to one that just assigns a kind of value to each position. And then the cost function becomes the cost of the trade DX given some current position of a market maker X is just going to be this difference in potential, if you like. So it's the value of the new position minus the value of the old position. So that's, you get that for free just by wanting this property of your pricing mechanism. So the game we're playing here is, want some way of pricing trades. If we want this condition, then we can represent the cost function as a difference of values between the final position and the start position of the market maker. Okay. Any questions about that so far? So how do we get a price out of this? So this cost function tells you how much an agent should pay the market maker if they want to buy the trade DX. But we're interested in eventually getting prices out of these because they represent something about the aggregate belief. So if you think about it, you can think of what's called an instantaneous price. So if I buy an extremely tiny trade of one particular contract, then this difference is going to be very small. And if I need to divide out by DX, If I take the limit as dx goes to zero of this difference, I should get the derivative of this cost function. And this derivative is in some sense the price, because when the market's at a particular position x and an agent wants to move it in a very small amount in one direction, that's pretty much the definition of the derivative, and it ends up being the unit price for this at that position. And given a cost function, we'll define the instantaneous price pi of x to be the derivative of the cost function at x. And as we spoke about before, we want to avoid this situation where a market maker who's setting prices can get arbitraged. That is, we don't want agents to be able to make risk-free profits from the market maker. And to avoid arbitrage, there's some results that say you basically need your prices to be probabilities. They have to be all positive, and the prices have to sum to one for every position the market maker can be in. And it turns out that we needed path independence to get cost functions to be written as a difference of values. We want instantaneous prices, so in some sense we need the cost function to be differentiable, and we want to avoid arbitrage, and these are all fairly natural conditions. It turns out if you require all of these conditions of a cost function, it turns out they have to be basically risk measures that I mentioned earlier. So the cost function ends up being basically a risk measure with a little change in sign. So the way to think about this is because there's a bit of asymmetry in buying and selling from the market maker's point of view. So what am I trying to say? So the market maker is basically a risk-based agent, and it's just that its risk is reversed because it's buying when agents are selling and vice versa. And so if you have these fairly natural conditions on a way of valuing trades, then it turns out that the cost functions you have to be these risk measures. And so a simple example of a cost function is just by plugging in the entropic risk here, and we get that we should price positions, we should value positions x according to this sort of log sum x function. So this is this type of analysis is actually in a paper from 2011 by Jake Abernethy, Yiling Cheng, and Jen Vaughan, and it's quite nice. It sets up some nice natural conditions that you might want of a market maker that's using this cost function, and then derives the that they have to actually be risk measures. Okay, so I realize I went through that pretty quickly. Are there any questions that I'm happy to sort of talk about this a bit more if anyone wants anything cleared up? Right, so these are in my mind, these are kind of the most interesting types of market maker because of the properties I mentioned earlier, and because they have this, with very few assumptions, you get a lot of nice structure in the form of these risk measures. So how do you set up a market maker with these cost functions? You just, every time a trader wants to trade with this market maker, it will sell a bundle DX to a trader in return for the trader paying this difference in, here. So a trader comes along and says, I want to buy the trade DX, and the market maker says, sure, I'll sell that to you, but you've got to pay me this change in position. So this, from the market maker's point of view, you think of this X as all of the obligations that the market maker owes all of the agents. So every time an agent comes along and trades with the market maker says, here, sure, have some contracts. And the sum total of all the contracts the market maker has sold is in some sense its obligation. So it's this vector of amounts of contracts, and if outcome I occurs, then they have to pay out all that money to all of the agents who hold those contracts. So this position X for the market maker represents the sort of net obligation of the market maker to all the traders. And And we can ask the question, how much can a market maker potentially lose by this scheme? So if you think about the market maker having some initial position X naught, it might be zero. After it trades for a while, it might have some net position X. This is the sum of all of the trades it's done with all of the agents to date. And so, as I was saying, if outcome I happens, this quantity in red, the payout, is how much money the market maker has to dole out to all of the agents who have contracts for that particular outcome. But that's the payout. But in the meantime, every time an agent's bought one of these contracts, the market maker's collected some cash. And the cash will basically be the difference between the value of the current position minus the value of the starting position. So the net loss to the market maker will be this payout on option I minus the income it's gained. Right. So we can ask the question, well, what happens in the worst possible case from the market maker's point of view? What's the largest this difference between payout and income can be? Well, one expression you can write down is just take the supremum over all possible outcomes of this expression here. But it turns out that I'll get into this in a second, but the cost function is actually dual to some other function. Should have put that stuff before this, but basically you can bound the worst case payoff in terms of a function that's related to the cost function, and the bound is basically if you consider pi to be the initial belief of the initial prices of the market maker, then this difference here represents some value of the value of some arbitrary belief minus the value of the initial belief of the market maker. And turns out that this supremum is actually equal to the supremum over this one, and depending on your choice of cost function, this you can get a bound on this quantity, so it ends up being finite, and so you can guarantee that the market maker can't lose an infinite amount of money. I'll explain what this strange relationship is in a second, but it turns out to be quite neat. But to explain it, I have to sort of take a brief diversion into some convex analysis, but I think several of you said that you picked up some of this when you're doing one of the earlier classes, so hopefully this will just be a brief refresher. So after playing around with these things for a while, I realized that the convexity pops up very, very naturally in these sort of market mechanisms. The reason they pop up very naturally is related to that funny diagram I showed you before. So I'm going to define this expected score here to be this expectation under belief P of SI of Q, so some report Q and some score SI. And as I showed you in that picture before, if I know what the value of the score for outcome 0 is for a particular report Q1, and the score at outcome 1 is for the same Q1, then the expected score is a linear function of the belief. I just get a straight line connecting the two scores at the different outcomes. And as I change the report, I just get different lines. So these S1 and S2 can be chosen fairly. Sorry, S0 and S1 functions can be chosen fairly arbitrarily, but for any choice of functions, if I plug in a report, I get a straight line. And there's a result from convex analysis that says if I take the supremum of a bunch of convex functions, I get a convex function, and all of these linear functions are convex, kind of trivially, and so their infimum is going to be their supremum is going to be a convex function, and we're going to call it H. So H here is it's not the argmax, it's just the max. So for every value p, we'd like to ask what's the maximum expected score. And so for this value of p, if I reported Q3, I would get an expected score here. If I reported Q2, I'd get an expected score here. But if I reported Q1, I'd get an expected score up here. So that for the value of p, that's the value of h I get. And you can see that if I let q range over lots of different lines, I'll trace out this convex function. So another interesting result you can get directly from this graph is that you can sort of work out what the score at any point should be. You sort of start at h of q, and then you have to move down a certain amount according to the derivative of the score. I won't go into that. But anyway, the point here is that that once you set up a score, you get this very natural function, which I'm calling h, and it's in general, I'm going to call this an entropy, even though it's sort of upside down. But it's a function of probabilities. For each probability, you get a value on this convex function. And the other concept I'm going to need is one called convex duality. So who's seen this before? Right. So a convex dual is a very nice property of functions where you basically replace evaluating a function point by point with evaluating a function via its tangents. So the definition of a convex conjugate says that if I have some function x, I construct this function for some value s by taking the supremum of the difference between the inner product of s and x and f of x. And graphically, what you're doing is you're saying, this is my function f of x. I want to maximize, if I choose some s, which you can think of as a slope, you want to maximize the difference between the line with slope s, which is, I have formula s transpose x. You want to maximize the difference between that and the function f of x, because that's going to be the difference s t of x minus f of x. So to maximize this, I actually want to find the point for which this red dotted line is tangent to the function f of x. And the amount I have to shift it down is actually going to be the negative value of the dual here. So convex conjugates have a nice geometric interpretation in the sense that you can sort of see through this diagram that I'm going from... It sort of matches up the value of a function at a point with the value of its tangent at the same point. And indeed, if the function's differentiable, you can write down an expression of the convex conjugate in terms of the gradients. One of the key properties I use a lot is that the structure you get here means that the gradient of the convex conjugate of S is an inverse to the gradient of F. So this is a nice way of mapping between tangent spaces. There's this result from the economics literature and mathematical finance literature that uses convex analysis to say something about the structure of risk measures. So remember, risk measures are these things that are monotonic, convex, and cash invariant. It turns out if you have all those properties, then risk measures are just dual to the convex function defined over probabilities. So there's a theorem that says if I have a convex risk measure rho of x, there's some convex function defined over probabilities so that rho of x is just the convex conjugate of this function alpha. So sort of at a high level, what's happening here is that because there's this very natural correspondence between prices or probabilities and positions via taking expectations, it sort of stands to reason that you'd get a relationship between a function over positions in terms of a function over prices, and that relationship is precisely convex conjugation. The theorem also says that if you start with one of these functions over probabilities and you take its convex dual, you get a function that satisfies all the properties of a risk measure. It's convex, monotonic, and cache invariant, which is pretty cool. And so here, it's this result that actually matches up scoring rules, entropies, and risk measures, because that result just told us that a risk is the convex conjugate to some convex function, or an entropy, if you like, over probabilities. And we saw how to construct, that should just be max, not arg max. We saw how to construct from a proper score this sort of upper envelope of all of the expected scores. And this happens to be a convex function which takes in probabilities as well. And the question is, can we relate them? And you can, because if I start with a score, I can construct an entropy, and from it I can construct a risk. And as an example, if I start with the log score, I get the negative of the classical entropy, the sum of a pi log pi. And if I take its dual, I get the entropic risk, which we saw earlier, this log sum x type operator. So you can kind of, there's a very nice relationship between scoring rules and cost functions, and it's via this conjugate duality. And it should sort of be intuitive because, like I said, it's sort of jumping between two spaces, a space over positions, and it's sort of dual space, which is over probabilities. So I've done a bunch of work on this this type of picture. So imagine this is a space of probabilities. That's the space of positions. These entropy functions and their derivatives allow you to basically jump between the two spaces. And in markets, the probabilities are like prices. The H and H star are entropies or costs, and the dual representation on that side are contracts. It turns out in exponential families, you get a similar correspondence, and the H star corresponds to the log partition function. And in learning theory, you get loss vectors and mixture potentials and stuff like that. So this is one of the things that got me intrigued in prediction markets, because it was this same kind of convex duality picture popping up in various places, and they're all quite closely related. Right, so I'll try and give you a very quick survey now of some of the results that connect prediction markets to machine learning. I'll skip the overview in the interest of time. I'll talk briefly about learning with expert advice. Who's seen this model of learning before? Oh, okay, so we're going to play a game where experts forecast the weather, and we have to basically choose some weighting over experts where the weight represents how much we trust their prediction. Or another way to put it, if we had to choose one at random, how would we assign the probabilities of choosing each of the experts? Weather gets observed each day. Experts get some penalty based on their prediction, and we just get some mixture of the penalties. And our aim is to, we get a total penalty at the end of T rounds, and we want to make sure we're not too bad compared to any of the other experts. So imagine on Monday, this guy is fairly confident that it's sunny, and this guy is fairly confident it's cloudy, and I don't have much of an opinion between who's right, and it turns out to be cloudy. Then this guy gets a big penalty because he was close to the sunny, this one gets a little penalty, and I get some mixture of the two. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to update my confidence in the first guy, shift my mixture that way a little bit. And on the second day, this guy predicts cloud, this guy predicts sun, but it was sunny. And so I get a penalty that's a mixture of their two penalties. And so I update my probability towards this guy now, and you play over and over. And then at the end of, say, 3 days, this guy's picked up a total penalty of 18, this one's picked up a total penalty of 8, and this one's got a penalty of 13, and I've got a total penalty of 13, and I want to make sure that this number is close to the smallest of all of the other guys' numbers. So this is a fairly well-studied model in learning theory called learning with expert advice, And ultimately, we want some way of choosing these weights so that the algorithm be what's called no regret. That is, we want this difference here to be sublinear in t. So we want to eventually converge to the best expert. There's a fairly intuitive algorithm for choosing these weights. It's called follow the leader. And all we do is we just keep track of the past performance of all of the experts, and we choose a weight that minimizes the mixture of the past performances. So if L sub KT is the performance up to round T of expert K, then this is going to be, you know, if we were to use W on all of the previous rounds and it was fixed, this would be our penalty to the present day, and we just want to make that as small as possible. So if you look at this for a bit, you realize that this algorithm will always end up putting all of its mass on one expert, because this is just a linear, we're just optimizing a linear function, and we're going to be constrained that the weights be probabilities, so it's going to put all of its weight on the expert with the lowest total loss to date, which we can call the leader. And this algorithm turns out doesn't work that well, because it's too jumpy. I have two experts, and basically they alternate for the lead. You can construct a sequence of losses so that because the mixture I'm choosing is jumping between the two, the regret I get actually grows like the number of rounds. And so that's bad. So that algorithm doesn't work, but there's a result that sort of tweaks that algorithm called follow the regularized leader, and it basically just kind of settles down that jumping and makes sure that the weight vector you choose doesn't always end up in all on one expert. So the follow the regularized leader algorithm just assumes that we have some convex function over weights. These are going to be distributions over k experts. And instead of just finding the weight that minimizes the past performance, we introduce this extra term, r of w, with some learning rate parameter eta, and we minimize this past performance, but we make sure that we don't put all of our mass on one expert. And it turns out that if you choose this regularizer to be the entropy, you get weights that are of this form here. So you basically take the past performance, and you take e to the negative past performance, so that experts that have a lower weight have a lower total penalty, get a higher weight, and vice versa. And this should look familiar if you've done any work in exponential families and stuff like that. So a long time ago, 1994, it was shown that this algorithm actually gets sublinear regret. It grows like square root t instead of t. But the reason we're interested in it is that it actually turns out that style of algorithm is exactly what these cost function marker makers are doing. So specifically, these cost function marker makers can be shown to get these bounded loss guarantees. I mentioned before that the total loss to a market maker is bounded by this difference in these alpha functions. So it turns out you can, if someone gives you a cost function based market maker with one of these bounded loss guarantees, you can turn it into a follow the regularized leader algorithm with a no regret guarantee, and vice versa. If you give me a no regret algorithm, I can turn it into a cost function based market maker. And the trick is basically the regularizer for the follow the regularized leader is actually the dual of this cost function for the market maker. And the weights that we assign in the follow the regularized leader correspond to the prices we derive from the cost function in the cost function-based market maker. The other kind of trick with this correspondence is that experts in follow the regularized leader correspond to outcomes in the market maker setting, and the sort of loss over experts vector ends up corresponding to trades in the market maker setting. So this was a very cool result from 2010 that really drove home that to me that you can view a lot of these market making algorithms as learning algorithms and vice versa. thought that was pretty neat. So just briefly, so some people have taken this correspondence and asked the question whether or not you could use it to build artificial markets consisting of agents that maybe have their beliefs constructed by learning algorithms. And it turns out if you have control over the utilities that each of the agents in your market use, and they're coming up with beliefs in, maybe they're running on different data sets or something like that, and they're coming up with different beliefs, it turns out if you set up one of these cost function based market makers and you assign the agents all linear utility, then the prices of this machine learning market end up being something like the median of all of the beliefs of the agents in the market. If you set all of the agents to have log utility, you get something like a weighted average of all of the predictions of the beliefs of the agents, and the weights are actually related to the wealth of the agents that you give to them. And if you use exponential utility, you end up getting what's called a product of experts model. So these various kind of, they're almost like ensemble techniques for machine learning algorithms, actually correspond to different models of agent utility in these prediction markets. And there's stuff towards the end of this paper. This is by a guy called Amos Storkey about 4 years ago. If you make some further assumptions about which agents trade on which contracts, you end up getting markets that look a lot like graphical models, and the message passing algorithms in graphical models end up looking a lot like trades in these markets. So that's something I've looked into a little bit, but I don't fully understand yet. I'll skip that. This is basically some work I did with the co-author about understanding maximum expected utility agents in cost function markets as a kind of mirror descent optimization. Turns out that the trades actually implement a stochastic mirror descent over an objective that you can express in terms of the demands of the agents in the market. And there's this nice result that if you assume that all the agents are Kelly bettors, you can write down exactly what objective the market as a whole is minimizing, and it's trying to minimize the KL divergence between its price and the wealth-weighted average belief of agents. And we're actually able to show that in these special cases that the problem that the market maker is solving actually matches up with the equilibrium prices of the same market. That was kind of cool. There's some nice work that's very recent, just only last year, where you, instead of assuming that agents are maximum expected utility based, you assume that they're trying to minimize risk in a cost function based market maker. And turns out this is mathematically a lot nicer than trying to understand maximum expected utility agents in these markets. And you end up getting a very nice closed form expression for the optimization that the overall market is trying to solve in terms of the risk measures of all of the agents. And very recently, only sort of a couple of months ago, a co-author of mine and I were able to generalize this to sort of arbitrary networks. Instead of just having a cost function market maker at the center and lots of agents interacting with it, like in a star graph, we're able to show that if you have arbitrary network topologies of agents and they're all interacting, then surprisingly the global optimization problem they're solving is independent of the network structure, and we're able to prove the convergence rates for these networks and that closed a couple of open problems. And actually the objective you can write down very simply as it's the sum of these entropy functions for all of the agents, and it's sort of independent of the network structure. And we're able to show that the market prices converge to the equilibrium prices. And I guess I'll skip that last one. Oh, this very, very quickly, imagine you were repeatedly playing the jelly bean guessing game, and I was paying out the contracts at the end of each game so that you got a certain amount of wealth. And then your newfound wealth would allow you to make different bets in the subsequent round of the same game. It turns out that this change in wealth as you repeatedly play a game, possibly with a different number of jelly beans each time, this change in wealth actually follows Bayes' rule if you assume that the market maker is a logarithmic market scoring rule market maker and the agents are log utility agents. So the initial wealth is like the prior probability over each of the agents in your market, and the wealth after each outcome is like the posterior probability. That's work from a few years ago. So basically, that was a very, very speedy overview over some of the interesting connections between market making and machine learning. I'm happy to talk about them after this for a little bit or via email. But basically, the take-home points is that these market mechanisms are a really nice way of aggregating distributed predictions, and a lot of mathematics is shared between techniques in learning theory and machine learning more generally, and these analysis of these prediction markets, and a lot of that is based on this really rich duality theory that's based on convex analysis. Some stuff that I'm doing at the moment is there are other market mechanisms that can be understood as learning algorithms. Do we get different insights across these two fields? Can we use other ML algorithms off the shelf, not just this follow the regularized leader, to price contracts in prediction markets? That's about it. So, thanks. Not the convergence time, the fact that you converge. Where you converge to is independent. The convergent time is you get a kind of 1 over T rate of convergence to the optimal, but this rate of convergence actually depends on the graph Laplacian of your network. Yeah, it pops up. So basically what determines the constant in front of this rate of convergence is the second eigenvalue of the graph Laplacian.
And this is like the synchronization.
Sorry? The
synchronization over like
network control. Not sure. I'm not too familiar with that.
It has been studied.
Okay, cool. Maybe you can send me a pointer to that. But this is work we sort of finished up last month, so it's pretty new to us. So if you've got any other possible connections, I'd love to hear them.